Bigfoot, and the abominable snowman, three giant creatures whose legends are kept alive by the many people around the world who continue to believe. When I proposed a contemporary investigation of the subject as one of our Smithsonian specials, I met with great resistance. The consensus was that no reasonably educated person would buy this stuff. I gave my word that scientists would be given equal time to challenge the true believers and their versions of proof. And with some reluctance, I was given the go-ahead. This program was, and still is, the highest-rated documentary in the history of television. Apparently, a lot of intelligent people were interested. I doubt if it changed anybody's mind, but I'm sure you'll have as good a time as the original audience. And now, with Rod Serling as host, Monsters, Mysteries, or Myths.
Loch Ness, Scotland.
I told my friend, there is the Loch Ness Monster, and it was an absolutely huge, huge animal.
And this huge black neck suddenly appeared, 7 or 8 feet, moving along quite slowly like this, with no humps visible, but quite clearly about 15 seconds before it went down.
Well, then, of course, when we told people about it, nobody believed us at the time. They said, oh, you've seen a water kelpie or something, and pulled our legs. They didn't believe it. But we knew we'd seen the thing. It was really terrifying.
The Himalayan mountain range, Asia.
I saw the abominable snowman on the western slope 100 yards away from me.
The Pacific Northwest, the United States.
I felt something staring at me, or a feeling of being watched. And I turned around, and that's when I saw Bigfoot. I was terrified.
Well, I was in shock. The totally unexpected. And in the only equation I could make on this thing is that it was a gorilla.
And we saw this hairy-looking animal crossing the road on its hind legs, and I can't tell you for sure what it was, but I believe it was Bigfoot.
Do monsters dwell among us, or are they only apparitions walking in the landscape of our minds? Are they subjects for zoologists or psychologists?
Some people want to believe in the existence of monsters because they make the world more colorful and exciting. As children, we live in a fantasy world and create all sorts of imaginary beings. But as we mature, we're taught to be less credulous and to believe only in that which can be proven to exist. Most of us are able to give up our imaginary creatures, but some people can't. They create monsters that provide an outlet for their internal fears. By embodying these nameless fears in strange creatures, they externalize them and make them easier to deal with.
Man has always been quick to believe in monsters. They are beliefs born out of the unknown, nurtured by the unexplained, beliefs difficult to disprove. Some monsters, however, have had a basis in fact. For centuries, Western man had heard rumors about a legendary man-monster that roamed the jungles of darkest Africa. It wasn't until the late 19th century that science caught up with the legendary monster, calling it the gorilla. New biological species are being found each year, like the Komodo dragon in 1912 and the okapi about 1900. Yet some creatures remain myths.
Myths are a part of universal folklore as humans seek to explain a practice or a belief. The Smithsonian is concerned with studying truth and seeks to explain beliefs as well as preserve objects associated with them. Myths about strange creatures seem to hold a never-ending fascination for the public. Thousands of inquiries have been directed to the Smithsonian asking about the possible existence of various creatures. including the Loch Ness Monster, Bigfoot, and the abominable snowman.
In the last decade, over 300 reported sightings of Bigfoot have been recorded in America. In 1973 alone, there were 33 reported sightings. This year, 9. Called Momo in Missouri, the Falk Monster in Arkansas, the Skunk Ape in Florida, Sasquatch in Canada. The giant monster is said to have migrated here across the Bering Straits land bridge that once connected Alaska to Asia. A relative of the Bigfoot has been reported seen in the Russian Caucasus, where it's called the Almista. Another relative is said to live in the Himalayas. Here in the highest mountains of the world, it is known as the Abominable Snowman, or the Yeti. In Kathmandu, Nepal, nearby famed Mount Everest, Sanskrit scholar Yogi Narahari Nath tells of his encounter with the creature.
I saw a Yeti while I was trekking with 60 other people in the western Himalayas. I was 100 yards ahead of my friends when I saw an ugly-looking black creature walking like a man. It was hairy and naked, and it moved fast.
The culture and religion of the mountain people of Tibet and Nepal, the Sherpas, are filled with tales and dances of demons. Some are of the abominable snowman. The Yeti is considered an evil spirit to be feared. Among some, it is considered fatal to even look upon a Yeti. Part of the mountain people's lives for centuries, the snowman only became known to the West in the late 19th century when British mountaineers began to attempt to conquer Mount Everest. Cool-headed explorers returned with tales of the mysterious Yeti, tales of strange footprints left in the snow. But it wasn't until 1951 when veteran climber Eric Shipton discovered a new pass at 19,000 feet that actual evidence was collected. Shipton, standing where no man had ever been before, took these photographs of giant man-like tracks. Once a non-believer in the Yeti, Shipton, now in London, recovering from a back ailment, remembers that day.
Strange feeling inside. I've often seen these tracks before, but hitherto I'd always been a bit of an agnostic about the whole question. But seeing these tracks so absolutely fresh and clear, well, there seemed to be no doubt about it at all. And it was that really gave me a very eerie feeling. That here one was in the presence of something quite unknown.
What the footprints show are the tracks of an animal that moves on 2 feet for long distances. The only animal known to do this is man. Further, the footprints, larger than those of apes, show no claw marks normally associated with bears.
David L. Wolper presents. We'll continue.
Additional evidence was collected in 1953. While directing the Hillary expedition, the first to reach the top of Everest, Lord John Hunt says he heard the Yeti.
This was during the 1953 expedition when we were doing some training, expedition training, in the mountains on the east of Everest, and I myself, with some of my companions and Sherpas, were camping beside a glacier behind a mountain called Armadablung. It was the Armadablung Glacier, and it was at about 18,000 feet. And one evening in that camp, I distinctly heard what seemed to me to be a yelping call or cry from the other side of the glacier. I wondered what it was, and the Sherpas with us were unanimous in saying this is a Yeti. I think the nearest equivalent sound is the sound made by an ape, which does have a yelping cry.
Almost seen by Westerners. The Yeti was once reportedly glimpsed by N.A. Tombazi of Athens, Greece. It was during an expedition to Everest in 1925. Here, from his descriptions, is a recreation of what Tombazi said he saw in a clearing 300 yards away. A dark and hairy man-like creature grubbing for roots with a stick. Thought to be a missing link, a creature unchanged from the Ice Age, perhaps even an ancestor of Neanderthal man. The snowman became the object of extensive expeditions. Year after year, teams from England, France, America, and Japan combed the mountains for proof that the snowman did exist. Anthropologists and naturalists joined in the search, looking in vain for bones or a dead carcass, for something physical to bring home to a Western world of skeptics. Among the things they did find was this cave in 1958, said to be the lair of the Yeti. And in 1961, what was said to be the hide of a Yeti. And even its alleged mummified hand. And what was said to be the hide of a Yeti scalp. These artifacts, plus eyewitness testimony, convinced many of the Himalayan travelers that the snowman did exist. The leader of one expedition, however, does not agree. Sir Edmund Hillary, the first man to reach the top of Everest, led an expedition in 1960 to search for the snowman. After analyzing the mysterious footprints in the snow, he contends they were made by known animals. Footprints, he said, change shape, grow larger as they continuously melt and refreeze. He brought the alleged artifacts of the Yeti back to England for examination. The scalp turned out to be that of an antelope, the hide that of a bear.
I believe that many of the sightings, perhaps, of the abominable snowman came from people seeing this very rare animal, the Tibetan blue bear. One reason for saying this is that we obtained some skins of the blue bear, and on seeing them, the Sherpas would immediately say, "Yeti, Yeti," because all the markings on the chest and on the creature fitted in with the stories they'd told us about what the Yeti looked like.
At the Smithsonian Institution, Secretary S. Dillon Ripley, ornithologist and a veteran traveler in the Himalayas, agrees.
I am convinced that it is possible in the mountains to have things elude one for generations. There are several birds that I'm still looking for and hope to find before I'm through. I'm also convinced that this kind of vast space high up does have an effect on people. The first trip I made in the Western Himalayas when I was 13 years old, I became entirely aware of the sensitivity of the Tibetans who lived there towards myth and legend and folk tale. It is quite possible as you go by a mountain where there is a narrow gulch and a stone comes rolling down soundlessly, just missing your head, barely avoiding you, as it were, it's quite possible to believe that someone, some evil genius, just rolled that stone down. If you project this kind of imaginatory thing, this episode where a real stone just misses you, at the altitude of 13, 14, 17, 18, 20,000 feet, whatever it may be, you can easily realize that it's a question of mental imagery and the possibility that you yourself can be deluded.
And yet, reports of the abominable snowman's possible existence continue to come in. In July 1974, a Sherpa girl, Lakpa Doma, claimed she was attacked by the snowman. In the last several years, however, a search for a similar creature has begun elsewhere, in America, where the giant is said to have migrated on what was once the Bering Straits land bridge. In the Dalles, Oregon, the first center has been opened to collect known data on the alleged monster, the American Yeti, known as Bigfoot.
What happened? Did you think you actually saw something or heard something? Okay, did it look like a man? Was it walking upright? Okay, how big do you think it was?
Before coming here, Peter Byrne of Ireland previously spent 16 years in the Himalayas looking for the Asian counterpart of Bigfoot.
I decided to leave the Himalaya and come here and get into the Bigfoot investigation and search because I felt there was more chance of coming to a conclusion in this area, in this country. Here, there are many advantages that we didn't have in the Himalayan searches. There's a system of roads that enable you to get into the backcountry. There's communications, telephone, radio, and so on. We had none of these things in the high Himalaya. The terrain was extremely difficult. We could have gone on for years and years there, I think. Whereas here, although it's been 3.5 years, I think we will come to a conclusion quite soon.
First found in Indian folklore, Bigfoot has become an American legend. Now, some hope to prove that legend a reality.
David L. Wolper presents. We'll continue.
Does a wild, giant, man-like monster called Bigfoot roam the American forests? Could a sizable population of 8-foot, 500-pound creatures exist on the edge of an industrialized society? American scientists emphatically say no.
I don't care what other people think. I saw Bigfoot 10 years ago. I was with 11 other Boy Scouts at the time. And we were camping 18 miles south of Butte in the Deer Lodge National Forest. We had walked in to the forest about 5 miles that day.
In this dramatic recreation is what Dan Malachny and two of his friends claim they saw. It was after a long day of hiking and a long night of telling mysterious tales around a campfire. For the more impressionable, sleep was long in coming and short in duration. Whatever it was in the forest, Dan's friend was the first to sense it. First to hear it.
Yeah.
In the area where most of these footprints have been found, A privately funded expedition sponsored through the National Wildlife Federation hopes to photograph a live Bigfoot or produce evidence of a dead one. Under the direction of Robert Morgan of Miami, Florida, the group has already claimed discovery of additional footprints in Oregon and Washington. They believe a colony of over 200 Bigfoot creatures inhabit the unexplored wilderness of the Pacific Northwest. The expedition has tried to anticipate the creature's movements, running the roads, keeping a watchful eye for any evidence of its passing. Thinking Bigfoot to be a nocturnal creature, they're prepared to penetrate the darkness of night with special light amplification viewing devices. Morgan, a former government computer specialist, began to pursue Bigfoot only after having seen one, he says, in 1957.
And all of a sudden, this thing went through the bushes. He didn't go around. He went, I mean, I could see the wake, you know, just plowed right through it. And he moved up at an angle away from me. I was on the edge of a canyon. And at a point, I estimate about 40 yards from me, it went into an opening, a clearing in the brambles. And what I saw was the most manlike looking gorilla, in my estimation, that I'd ever seen.
In their search for evidence, monster hunters must always be on guard against the hoaxer, like Ray Pickens of Chehalis, Washington. 7 times, beginning in 1971, Pickens has tracked the wilderness with bogus Bigfoot tracks. His purpose, not to fool the scientists, but to fool the monster hunters. He tells us why.
Well, we were sitting there having coffee at this Arden Cafe, and two gentlemen came in, and they was asking us about Bigfoot. We said, well, we didn't believe in it. And one gentleman says, well, you hicks around Arden probably wouldn't. And I turned to my friend, which his name is Harvey, and I says, Harvey, we're hicks. What are we going to do about it? And he says, yeah, what are we going to do about it? I says, we're going to show them who the hicks are. And then I went home and made boots. And by the time the next day was over, there was 700-800 people looking at the tracks from all over the country.
There are a number of footprints that I've seen that are faked, and this can be done. But on the other hand, there are a few that show some characteristics that I think could not have been faked. This is one such footprint. This cast, I've drawn in the approximate reconstructions of the bones. This is a crippled individual where a couple of bulges have extended out between adjacent bones on the outer edge of the foot. If this had been a human foot, these bulges would have been farther back. But they're shifted forward, making the heel longer and the front of the foot shorter. This is exactly what is required for a foot that's going to carry perhaps an 800-pound body. Now, I don't think any faker could have thought of it and figured this out and adjusted his footprint accordingly. A fake footprint is just simply an expanded, enlarged footprint or enlarged copy of a human foot.
Here, in actual footage taken of what is said to be a real Bigfoot, is a creature similar to Dr. Krantz's club-footed giant. Filmed by Ivan Marx in late 1969 in Bosberg, Washington, the film has been denounced as a fake by some monster hunters. Here is yet another film of an alleged Bigfoot, also taken by Marx in Alaska in 1973. Marx, a hunter and maker of nature films, insists on its authenticity. No matter what the Marx films indicate, the most compelling evidence for Bigfoot's possible existence remains that presented by eyewitnesses. Former Sheriff Oliver Potter.
Like I say, I'm a barn in the woods, the Cascade Mountains. I know the animals that are here. This was something different that I had never seen before. A large creature, about 7.5 to 8 foot tall. It was grayish black in color. And as it went away from me, I seen the backside of it walking as a man would walk on its hind legs.
It moved more or less like a man. And it was about 6-7 feet tall and probably a blackish brown color. And I couldn't see its face because it was running away from me across the road. And I actually, her and I both saw it disappear into the brush. I was born and raised around here, and bears just don't walk on his hind legs that long.
There were four of us in the car when I was the first one to sight it. We pulled up on the freeway and pulled back for optimum viewing.
Oh, I'd seen people from the same location and in about the same spot before. Humans up there, it probably was twice the size.
And it was a dark, dark brown, just swaying back and forth, sitting on a rock.
Could the people who say they've seen Bigfoot be seeing something else? A bear, perhaps? Or could the creature be only in their minds?
Eyewitness testimony in the case of Bigfoot, I don't think is very good, because you can't test it. It's the credibility of the person, and these people, they want to see something strange, they can imagine it.
Dr. Stewart is Director Emeritus of the Smithsonian Institution's National Museum of Natural History. He demands more proof before he'll accept Bigfoot.
I do not believe in Bigfoot because no hard evidence has been presented. All the evidence so far is in the form of footprints and such reports, all of which constitute soft evidence. Hard evidence is like this skull here. If you have a skull of this so-called Bigfoot, you can tell what it is.
Fact or fiction, Bigfoot has become a fixture in the American landscape. At Willow Creek, California, which proclaims itself the gateway to Bigfoot country, the creature is celebrated each year with a 3-day festival. Mysterious creature. creature seen in Loch Ness has allegedly been photographed. The first time in 1933 by Hugh Gray of London. Scientists could not agree as to what this was. Then in 1934, a vacationing London surgeon, Dr. Robert K. Wilson, took this photograph, said to be of the neck and head. That same year, the London Daily Mail printed this picture, describing it as a photograph of the monster's fin. Lachlan Stewart took this picture in 1951. The first to show what are said to be the mysterious humps that undulate on the creature's back. Then in 1955, Peter McNabb took a photograph showing a large object in relationship to the 64-foot tower of Urquhart Castle. In 1960, Peter O'Connor took this controversial photograph, which he claims is of a 50-foot creature. Over the years, the Loch Ness Monster has reportedly been seen mostly by the residents of the tiny villages on the loch side. The people who live here, fishermen and farmers, lead quiet, uneventful lives. Two natives discussed their sightings of the monster.
Oh, it certainly does. But a rounded hump, something like an elephant's back, and the same sort of colour. A greyish colour. And it stayed quite still for at least 2 minutes.
Both men claimed proof for what they saw, for at the time, neither was alone.
Well, this sighting of mine was also seen by the Oxford and Cambridge group who were up there to find out about the monster.
More or less.
There were about a dozen of them.
Well, it's very similar to mine because the entire holiday makers and the gondolier, and there must have been 120, all saw it.
The monster has been a part of the cultural tradition of northern Scotland since the year 565, when, it is written, St. Columba drove off the creature by invoking the word of God. The word of God is still invoked today. In 1972, the Reverend Donald Orman performed the rites of exorcism at Loch Ness.
I adjure thee, thou ancient serpent, by the judge of quick and dead, by him who made thee in the world, that thou cloak thyself no more in manifestations of prehistoric demons. Begone, thou hideous demon, unto thine appointed place, and return no more to plague the servants of Almighty God.
Not all residents around the loch perceive the monster as evil. The children at the Drumna Drocket grade school, who believe in the creature despite attempts to teach them otherwise, see it in a more affectionate way. They call it Nessie. Nessie, however, has been said at times to show a more sinister face, as when John Cobb, British speed champion, took his boat onto Loch Ness in 1952. Cobb was attempting to set a new world's record. Cobb was killed, his boat striking a mysterious turbulence, which some claim was caused by the monster. Among those who believe the theory that Cobb met his death because of the Loch Ness Monster is Tim Dinsdale, a former aeronautical engineer and now a full-time resident monster hunter. Dinsdale, who lives on the loch, in this boat, the Water Horse, has been watching the surface of the lake for 15 years. His vigil began in 1960, after he took what is claimed to be the most convincing film ever shot of the Loch Ness Monster. Using a 16-millimeter spring-wind camera with a 135-millimeter telephoto lens, Dinsdale filmed this moving object 1,300 yards away. He submitted the film for analysis to the Joint Air Reconnaissance Intelligence Center at the British Defense Ministry. They enlarged the film, as shown here, subjecting it to intense scrutiny. their conclusions, that the film is of an animate object, not a boat, that it is moving 10 miles per hour, and that it is 6 feet wide, 5 feet high. Dinsdale has interviewed almost every living eyewitness of the alleged monster. Here he describes what it might look like, based on these interviews.
Then you get this tremendous body. The forward limbs, I think, are rather smaller than the rear ones. These curious humps, of which I think there are two, basically, at the pelvic and the shoulder girdle, and this region in between seems to be able to appear, change shape. People have seen the back changing shape. They've actually watched it. And then up, right up the back end, you have, I think, a tremendous swimming tail, like a crocodile's tail, which is used to propel the thing through the water.
Dinsdale, who is not a scientist, speculates that Loch Ness might be inhabited by plesiosaurs, animals believed extinct for hundreds of millions of years. The theory is that plesiosaurs entered Loch Ness before the last ice age, when the lake had an outlet to the sea. That an animal believed extinct can still exist is shown in these films. The coelacanth, a fish thought to be extinct for 60 million years, was rediscovered near South Africa in 1938. The coelacanth was hidden in the open ocean. Loch Ness is landlocked, confined. Yet the question remains, could these waters be home to prehistoric creatures?
David L. Wolper presents, will continue, Monsters, Mysteries or Myths.
To finally determine what mysterious creatures, if any, live in these waters, the Loch Ness Phenomena Investigation Bureau was formed in 1962. Operating until last year, the Bureau attempted to bring a long-needed expertise in the search for the monster. For 11 summers, until they ran out of money, they trained eyes and cameras on strategic parts of the lake. Their major achievement, this film taken by a 17-year-old volunteer, Richard Rayner, in June 1967. British Air Force scrutiny of this film led to the conclusion that, like the earlier Tim Dinsdale footage, this was a picture of an animate object of some size. Director of the Investigation Bureau was Member of Parliament David James. He tells us what criteria the Bureau used in evaluating eyewitness testimony.
Well, if in doubt, we threw out. We never accepted any account within 15 minutes of a vessel passing either way, because you can get extraordinary wake effects, rebounding off the shore and so on. So multiple humps after within 15 minutes of boat, we rejected out of hand. We were very reluctant to accept any sighting report by a single witness, unless he happened to be someone who was experienced, like a gamekeeper or a naval officer with binoculars. But using the most rigid criteria we could, we found that on an average there were about 20 sightings a year, which we couldn't ignore.
There wasn't a cloud in the sky when five or six humps appeared about 200 yards away. And when I saw them, the thoughts that entered my mind were this: there was nothing there when we passed. It's not any creature I know. It fits the descriptions of the Loch Ness Monster. It must be the Loch Ness Monster.
This animal appeared, long, tapering neck, small head, huge hump, which I reckon 30 feet long, about 3 to 4 feet high at the apex. And I shut my eyes once, twice, three times to make quite sure I wasn't imagining seeing something. No, it was there all right.
The lock is a mysterious place. Shadows and wakes create peculiar effects. There are those who say anyone can be coaxed into seeing a monster in these waters. But if the monster is only an optical illusion or an hallucination, how can one explain these photographs, taken by a former professional army man, Frank Searle of London. Searle runs his own one-man investigation unit at Loch Ness. He lives hermit-like at water's edge, in a tent, with few comforts of modern living. He has been here now for 5 years. His goal, to get close-up pictures of the monster. He tells us why.
I figure it would be worth a lot of money. Just the use of the pictures by the media all over the world, I think, would fetch in something like about £200,000 over perhaps the first 6 months. After that, there would be lectures, personal appearances and so on, and royalties from the pictures.
Nicholas Witchell, law student and part-time monster hunter, in a new book published in London this summer, questions the authenticity of Searle's photographs.
I'm afraid there are people who are faking photographs on the loch at the moment. This is done by superimposing objects onto negatives and by placing objects in the water and then photographing them. And recently, these pictures have been getting a great deal of attention from the popular British press.
To get better pictures, the monster hunters took their cameras underwater in submarines for the first time in 1969. But the unusually peaty and murky darkness of the loch's waters closed off all possible visibility. The submarines were considered useless and were withdrawn. Better results have been achieved with sonar, sound waves which collect echoes off whatever object they bounce. The echoes are converted into electrical signals on shipboard graphic recorders. 3 times in 1969, 70, and 72, research teams acoustically exploring the depths of Loch Ness have had contact with large, moving, but not necessarily living, objects. The director of one of these expeditions was a Boston patent lawyer, Robert Rhines, who returned to Loch Ness in June 1974 to undertake a more ambitious underwater project.
You lower this there and have this sink into the silt and so forth.
Rhines' plans call for the dropping of 2 waterproofed cameras into the loch. The cameras are connected to a powerful strobe light and sonar recorder, all operated by a computer. When an object larger than 30 feet passes through the sonar beam, the computer will activate the strobe light and cameras. Every 10 seconds, another picture will be taken until the object passes out of the sonar's range. The equipment in place, a professional diver gives his opinion of working in Loch Ness.
You're dead right. I don't intend to go back to Loch Ness again.
Was it frightening?
It was frightening.
What was frightening about it?
The eerie darkness.
The buoy marks the location of the Rhines camera gear, 100 feet below the surface. Developed by Dr. Harold Edgerton of MIT, who also developed Jacques Cousteau's underwater equipment, this gear represents the current best hope of determining the monster's existence. In 1972, the Rhines team recorded this large object on the sonar screen, at the same time as it took this picture of a fin, said to be about 8 feet long, 4 feet wide. The fin, Rhines speculates, of the Loch Ness Monster. The Rhines fin bears a striking resemblance to the fins shown on the fossilized remains of plesiosaurs. Dr. Nicholas Hutton, a vertebrate paleontologist at the Smithsonian Institution, replies,
I think it's very unlikely that anything the size of a plesiosaur would be able to live in Loch Ness without our being aware of it long before now, or being able to live there, period. Because there just isn't enough room for something that big. In thinking about a plesiosaur, you have to think in terms of a moderate-sized whale as far as the amount of room it needs and the amount of food it needs. I can't give you very precise figures, but just to get sort of a ballpark order of magnitude, I would say that a reproducing population of plesiosaurs, whatever that is, maybe 40 individuals, we don't really know, but it would require a stretch of sea, depending on productivity, ranging along coastal waters, say from Chesapeake Bay down to, at least down to South Carolina or Georgia, and maybe all the way down to Florida.
There has been talk of electrifying the lake, of building giant nets, to find the hard evidence to determine if the creature exists. Without that evidence, the Loch Ness Monster must remain an intriguing but unsolved mystery.
Tales about strange creatures are always tantalizing. In time, some may even prove to be true. To date, however, in the absence of hard evidence, the scientists at the Smithsonian Institution do not endorse the reality of such creatures as Bigfoot, the abominable snowman, or the Loch Ness Monster. Undoubtedly, there are undiscovered biological species on Earth, and possibly in outer space. The scientists whose task it is to probe the unknown will one day discover these species.
They will continue to try to separate the myths from the realities, to help solve the mysteries of that part of the world still strange and unknown.
I hope you've enjoyed this presentation of Monsters, Mysteries, or Myths. Do you believe? I'm David Wolper. Thanks for watching.